The price has to be paid. And Jesus paid the price to rescue you, to deliver you, to purchase you, to redeem you. Knowledge delivers. His light. When light comes, darkness vanishes. There is a realm. The realm of Jesus. The realm of Moses is another realm. Moses carried the rod of Aaron. He divided the Red Sea. The testimony filled the whole Bible. But the man of the New Testament, he doesn't need to divide the Red Sea. He just walked on the water. He is the master. Woo! Shout hallelujah! That's the higher realm. He now said prophetically in Isaiah chapter 8 verse 18. He said, I, that's Jesus, and all the children whom the Lord has given me, they are for signs, they are for wonders. And until you come to the light, you don't understand all these things.
You're welcome to the Keys of the Kingdom, a program powered by Harvest of Nations Ministry, where God's servant, Pastor M.K. Adaramola, will be unveiling to us the keys that unlock the kingdom's treasure. Be blessed as you listen.
We worship you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. My dear viewers, I want to thank God for your lives. We continue with our subject on the keys of the kingdom. And today's episode, I'm going to an area that is very, very exciting. I want to show us the will of God for us when we come into the kingdom. So we'll be taking our lesson from 3 John today, verse 2. It's a very popular scripture among believers. And I know it will be of a great interest for you today. 3 John verse 2. And I want to, my pastor is also with me here in the studio to read the Bible along with me. Can we have that scripture? 3 John, Epistle of John, verse 2.
Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth.
Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Now, this word is from one of the foremost apostles of Jesus called John the Beloved. He is the writer of the Gospel according to St. John. Then he wrote 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and the book of Revelation. But in this third epistle that he wrote to the believers, it's only one chapter, and there is a powerful message in that place. And this verse 2 we have read summarizes all the total summation of the gospel of Christ. All that Jesus died for on the cross. And the apostle was addressing, especially this verse, he was addressing it to the believers that he called beloved. Beloved simply means brothers and sisters in Christ. And maybe perhaps as you are hearing me, you are also a child of God, you are born again, then the epistle is for you. And it's full of good news. He said, beloved, I wish above all things that one, that thou may prosper, that's talking about material prosperity or financial prosperity. Two, and be in health. That includes healing in case you are sick. And divine health, in case you're a believer, you can remain healthy for life. And even as thy soul prospereth, I call it the total gospel of Christ. and I call it all that Calvary has come to offer to humanity. And as a believer, you must enjoy these three principal things. But there's a truth that is hidden in that scripture that I want to share with you. First of all, I want you to note that what we have read in that verse 2, the apostle called it the truth. Let my pastor read verse 1 of that passage for us.
The elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth.
He mentioned truth, whom I love in truth. Yes?
Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth.
Now, that verse 2 is what he called the truth in verse 1. Now, look at verse 3. He called it the truth also.
For I rejoiced greatly.
I rejoiced greatly.
When the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth.
In the truth, almost about 3 or 4 times, the apostle mentioned the word the truth. What is the truth? Verse 2. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou may prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. So today's episode, I've brought a good news to you. That God saying, if you're a believer, if you're a child of God, then God wants you to prosper materially, financially, and in every aspect of life. Prosperity means having abundance, making progress, moving forward. And 2, he wants you to remain healthy, that you have good health. But then he now says, according to the prosperity of your soul. 3 things I mentioned. 1, your physical, material, financial prosperity. 2, the prosperity of your body, that is your divine health. And 3, the prosperity of your soul. Now, the first 2, material prosperity, very, very important. And, you know, the psalmist says, God, don't give me poverty, lest I deny you. A lot of people are compromising the gospel today because of poverty, because of lack, because they lack basic things. And sometimes some people can be driven to a corner that they will have to force to do certain things that they shouldn't have done. But God has a promise, or has a provision in Christ, provided from Calvary, that he wants us to prosper materially, he wants us to prosper financially. I want you to know that as a child of God, it is your birthright. Material prosperity is your birthright. Financial prosperity is your birthright. Prosperity in your career, prosperity in all the work of your hand, in everything that you are doing, is your birthright. And it's one of the benefits of the kingdom. And so that's why for some time we have been talking about how you can access the kingdom, how you can be qualified to enter into the kingdom. I'm talking about the kingdom of God here on earth. That is full of prosperity, blessing of God, provisions. Then 2 mentioned there is to be in health. I've seen a lot of sick people. Some of them wish that if somebody can take all the weight they have away to give them peace. Even Satan said the same thing in the book of Job. When he was tormenting Job, he said, a man can afford to give anything for his life, for his body. He said, let me touch his body. And I pray for somebody that is listening to me. Whatever may be the touch of Satan over your body, it shall be destroyed today in the name of Jesus Christ. So what I'm saying is that divine health is very, very important. Knowing fully that we are living in a world where we have a lot of challenges, health challenges. And I've said it over and over. Anytime I'm preaching on the crusade ground or in the church, I used to tell people to attend to spiritual healing. Why? Because so many diseases and sicknesses have no medical cure. They can only try. But experience has shown that that's not okay. For example, if you are with high blood pressure where you are, it doesn't have any cure, no way. Oh, they can manage it for you. They can, there are drugs they give you, but you know it's for life. Unless God intervene. Or you have sugar diabetes, for example. No cure. They give you something to maintain your sugar level, artificial insulin, and many other things. You know that it will not totally cure, that it will disappear. No drug that anybody can give you to use for these sicknesses and diseases I mentioned that can just take it away like that. Not to talk of cancer. Not to talk of somebody whose kidney fails. Not to talk of somebody who liver pack up or major organs of the body. Only God can do all those. But we are not talking about God saying one of the benefits of this kingdom is to have good health, not to be sick. It's possible. If it were not possible, God would not have promised one of the benefits of the kingdom. But then, in the passage we have read to you, there's a revelation I want to show you there. Now, all the good things of the kingdom, material prosperity, financial prosperity, healing and divine health, and many other blessings that the Bible promises is conditioned on one thing. Pastor, can you read that verse 2 to me again so that my viewers can hear it again?
Beloved, I wish above
all. Now, don't forget, he was writing to the beloved brothers and sisters in Christ. I wish above all things
that thou mayest prosper.
That God wanted to prosper.
And be in health.
And be in good health.
Even as thy soul prospereth.
Now, meaning that both physical prosperity and divine health is as your soul prospereth. That is, the prosperity of your soul will determine all the rest of the blessing. Now the question is, what does it mean for our soul to prosper? What's the Bible talking about? About the prosperity of our soul. Maybe you have never heard before. Prosperity of your soul is simply means that your soul salvation, the salvation of your soul, and that when you are born again, then you secure your soul with God, then God wants you to be growing in that grace of God. He wants your soul to be prospering. He wants the experience you have in God, experience of salvation, he wants it to begin to grow in it. So meaning that the growth rate of your spiritual life is directly proportional to the blessing you receive from God. I repeat myself so that you can understand. What I'm saying is that by the scripture we are reading together, it means that the growth rate of your spiritual life, the more you are growing in grace, growing in God, the more God's kingdom is expanded in your life, then is directly proportional to your spiritual blessing. So we now say those who are not growing in grace, those who are not growing in God, they are not developing as a Christian, they will find it difficult to accept the blessing of God. They will find it difficult to get the, miracles of God. And these are the problems we have today. That so many people, sometimes I'm worried, I'm concerned. A believer, we have sickness and the prayer, we attend program, and upon the whole, the sickness will not go. What's wrong? Some we have challenges. Some are being tormented by the devil. And they pray, fire, prayer, hot prayer. At the end of the day, the attack continues. Why? Very simple. John said, the prosperity of our material prosperity, blessing, healing, deliverances, everything is according to the prosperity of our soul. So briefly before I go today, as you know that I have just less than 30 minutes for this program, before I go today, I want to show you how your soul can be saved. And then how that soul can begin to prosper in the Lord. It's my prayer that today will be a turning point in your life as you accept the word of God. Now, where does it start? Number one, before anything can grow, it must come to life. It must have life. Anything without life cannot grow. So when the Bible is talking about the prosperity of your soul, therefore, it means that number one, your soul has to be born in God. You have to be born again. You must have eternal life. That life is the life of God. Pastor, can you read for me John Gospel chapter 1? Chapter 1, you can start reading from verse 3. John 1 from verse 3.
All things were made by Jesus. And without him was not anything.
Without Jesus, there was nothing that was made.
In him was life.
In Christ Jesus was life.
And the life was the light of men.
This life is the light of men.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Amen. Can you please connect that with chapter 14, verse 6? John 14, 6. You see, what we are saying is that the life, eternal life, was in Christ. And he came to give this eternal life to us at the point of our salvation when we were born again.
Jesus said unto him, I am the way.
I am the way.
The truth.
The truth.
And the life.
The life.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
So what I'm saying here is that your soul came alive or can come alive the moment you give your life to Jesus. And the life of Christ will enter into you. That's what we call eternal life. As many that have received him, he has given them eternal life. Please, can you read John chapter 1 verse 12?
But as many as received
him, as many that received Jesus,
to them gave he power to become sons of
God. He gave them power to become sons of God.
Even to them that believe on his name.
The next verse. Which were born. Yes.
Not of blood.
Not of blood.
Nor of the will of the flesh.
Of the will of the flesh.
Of the will of man, but of God.
So when you are born, when you give your life to Jesus, and you are, the Bible says you are born of God, you become a child of God. Then the life of God begins to live in you. So you become a living soul. So it is when you come alive, you are born again, you have repented from your sin, and you give your life to Jesus and you become a child of God, that you can be growing, because only living things can grow. Non-living things cannot grow. Somebody who has not been born again can never grow in grace. He cannot increase. There's no way he can make progress in life. And therefore, now you as a child of God, if truly you are born again, you have repented from your sin, you are now a child of God. Now, that scripture where we are coming from says that, beloved, I wish above all things that thou may prosper materially, financially, and be in health, even as thy soul, that is now alive unto God. That is the life of Christ have entered now, and you have eternal life, prosper. The word prospering means to be making progress. So, before you can enjoy all those things that have been promised, you must make spiritual progress. So, Christianity is not static. You must make spiritual progress, your soul must prosper. Now, this is where the issue is. So many people are not growing in grace. And so God wants us to grow in grace. Now, Pastor, can you read 2 Peter for me, chapter 3, verse 18? 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18.
But grow in grace.
Now, can you see what the Bible says? Grow in grace.
And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus.
Now, we are getting to where we are going. The Bible says for your soul to prosper, you must grow as a Christian. You grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now the question is, how do you grow in grace? Very simple. There are two elements that will help you to grow in grace. Two elements. Don't forget this. And I just pray I will be able to conclude before my time is up. Two elements for spiritual growth. There is more than that, but these are the two major ones. Number one is the word of God. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. When you are newly born again, when you are converted as a newborn babe,
desire the sincere milk of the word.
Okay?
That ye may grow thereby.
The Bible is saying here that as a young convert, maybe under this program, you have been born again, you have given your life to Jesus, or maybe your church or anywhere, you are now a newborn babe, you have the eternal life of Christ is inside you. You don't stop there. Have you ever seen a newborn babe that in the physical that doesn't eat? So the first thing that we establish in the kingdom, is that you must have a desire. The word desire means appetite, spiritual appetite, spiritual hunger for the word of God. He said, as a newborn babe, desire the sincere milk of the word. Initially, you may not be able to take solid food, but at least you can take the milk of the word of God. And I know, on this job, I know those who are really born again. The first sign you will see in their lives that they will be thirsty for the word of God. They'll be hungry for the word of God. And this is the problem we have today. Entertainment has taken over all our services, all our churches. And so the youth of today, and including the adults, they have no place for the word of God. If you are invited to a place now, they are comfortable when there's no preaching, with all the entertainment of the singing and the dancing and all the comedians, they can stay 4-7 hours. But the moment somebody comes to share the word of God that can give life, the word of God that can change people's life, the word of God that can make somebody to have a spiritual growth, you begin to see people not interested. From their countenance, you will know. But the Bible says one way to grow in grace is to have strong desire. Revival comes when there is strong desire for the word of God. And that's why today we are crying for another revival. That people will rush into the house of God just to hear the word of God, for Bible study, for the word of God. And so that's the first element of spiritual growth, the word of God. There must be thirst and hunger for the word of God. And you'll be longing to hear the word of God as a young convert. And then number two is prayer. So you love to pray. The kind of prayer I'm talking about is not the one you see today. I'm talking about personal praying for spiritual life, for growth, praying against temptation, praying again to destroy the work of the flesh, praying for the Spirit of God to fill your life. Now, when you are doing all that continuously on a daily basis, keep on reading the word of God, you are growing in grace. Then the grace of God will flow into your life. And the work of the flesh will begin to die. And then the Spirit of God will begin to fill you. Then back to the scripture we are reading. He said, I wish above all things that thou may prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. So this material prosperity, material blessing, and healing, and this physical blessing is directly proportional to your spiritual growth. And these are the things people never bother about. Now, a lot of Christians don't do quiet time. That is, when you wake up in the morning to have a time to read the Bible and also to pray for your personal development, some people, they don't do it. They are only content with the family altar and then they go to a place of work. You don't do that. You mean to grow spiritually. Then it is then, when you now call upon God to prosper you, you call upon God to heal you, then He will heal your body. Today, I'm going to pray for you as I share with you today. Maybe you are there, but you make up your mind that you want to be growing spiritually. But let me tell my friends that are hearing me or that you are watching me now that maybe you are not yet born again. You are not saved. And the Lord wants to forgive you and make you a child of God. I want to pray with you right away. You can close your eyes and confess your sin to God, ask Him to forgive you, and the Lord will forgive you. Let me have a prayer with you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these your people that want to give their life to Jesus and they are confessing their sin now. Forgive them in Jesus' name. I pray that, Lord, the blood of Jesus will atone for their sin in Jesus' name. Write their name in the book of life. Thank you, Lord, because I know you have forgiven them and they are not children of God. In Jesus' name, I pray.
I believe in miracles, supernatural. You are measuring it with the natural senses. These are natural. We are talking about supernatural, something that is not normal.
Now, today I've preached about material blessing, prosperity, and healing, divine health. You can be healed right away where you are. If you are having challenge, maybe cancer or tumor or sugar diabetes or any problem, today I want to minister to you. Just place your right hand upon your chest. I will pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for as many that are hearing me now and they need material prosperity. They need the blessing of God. Lord, I pray you prosper them in Jesus' name. All the yoke of poverty, I break it in your life now in Jesus' name. As many that are sick, Lord, I command that demons of sickness, I bind you and I cast away in Jesus' name. Receive your healing now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, because I know you have done it. In Jesus' mighty name, I have prayed. Amen and amen.
I know you have been blessed by the word of God and prayer. You can get back to us on the phone numbers displayed on the screen or on our YouTube and Facebook pages at Harvest of Nations. Thank you. Join us same time, same station next week. God bless.